One of my favorite things about syncing my entire Lightroom photo library in the cloud is that I can access any of my images from all of my devices from pretty much anywhere in the world. But more than that, I love that it syncs so much more than just my photos between Lightroom surfaces. In addition to syncing my edits, Lightroom will also sync what I consider to be its most underrated and powerful features, versions. Now, don't worry if you're unfamiliar with Lightroom's versions. I'm going to share a link to a video explaining it in greater detail at the end of this one. But at a very high level, and especially if you're a Lightroom Classic user, think of versions as a hybrid between virtual copies and snapshots, except that the versions you save will sync to the cloud and will be accessible in Lightroom desktop, mobile, and web. So now that I hopefully have piqued your curiosity, I'm going to share several practical use cases for versions and why it should absolutely be part of your editing workflow. All right, let's dive in. All right, so before I show you the different kind of practical uses for versions, I think it makes sense to show you how to access them with all of Lightroom surfaces. So we're going to start here with Lightroom Desktop. So this is the same whether you're using Lightroom Desktop on Mac or Windows. Along the right toolbar at the bottom, you're going to see this icon here. It looks like a clock with a counterclockwise arrow. And there's a tooltip here that says Versions with the keyboard shortcut of Shift V. When you click on it, you're going to see there are two tabs at the top. Now, like I mentioned, don't worry necessarily what these do, because at the end of this video, I have another video where I kind of dive deep into more of how Versions works. So you'll learn all about it there. But here you can see we have auto and named. And for the purposes of this video here, we're going to be working with the named versions, because this is where you can manually create versions ad hoc. Now I'm going to swipe over to Lightroom Web here, and you can see we've got the exact same photo, and it's a similar location here to access versions in Lightroom Web. Again, you've got your right toolbar. You're going to click on the same versions icon here. And then just like on desktop, we've got the auto and name tabs here. So you can click on named. And again, any named version that you save on any of the different surfaces of Lightroom will be accessible in all the other ones. So if I saved a version in Lightroom Desktop, it'd be available right here. So again, this is how to access it on Lightroom Web. And then finally, we've got Lightroom Mobile. And this is my iPhone 16 Pro Max. You'll see at the top towards the middle, there's that same versions icon. So if I tap this, this kind of serves double duty in Lightroom Mobile, where you have the ability to undo and redo edits, as well as access versions and reset the image. So here, if we tap on versions, you can see on the bottom here, there is named and auto. So this is where any of your named versions will appear. Now, for the purposes of this video, I'm going to be working in Lightroom Desktop. But again, everything I do here in terms of like saving and syncing versions, you can do on any other of Lightroom surfaces. So the first practical use case for versions is, let's say you have a photo, like I have this photo here. I took this, when did I take it? A long time ago, 2011. And this was the original edit that I applied. This is not the original photo. If I press the backslash key, you'll see this is the original photo. And this is what I did in terms of my treatment. Now, as you probably are well aware, as you kind of experience photography and you get older and you just develop different tastes and styles, the edits that you applied to a photo years ago may not be what you would want to do today. But that's not to say that you want to get rid of that style. Like for me, I would never want to just get rid of an edit that I made. I want to preserve it, but I also want to give myself the opportunity to start over. So that's where versions is perfect, because watch, you can see again, I have this edit. So what I can do is I can go to versions here. And again, I'm going to make sure that I am in the named section of versions, and I'm going to click on create version. Now here, this allows you to create a name for your version. You can call this whatever you want. I'm just going to call this 2011 original edit. And I'm going to click on create. And so now what's happening is you can see there is my version, and it's going to be synced to the cloud, and it will be accessible everywhere. And in fact, if I go over to Lightroom Web again over here, and I go to versions, you can see there is that version that I just created. And if I switch back to Lightroom Mobile over here and I tap on versions again, you can see there is the 2011 original edit. So in like 3 seconds from saving that named version, it was available in Lightroom Web and Lightroom Mobile. And that to me is super powerful, but that's not the point. Again, the point is I'm using versions to preserve the original edit I applied over a decade ago, and now I can add a new treatment. And so now what I can do is I can click on original over here, and that applies basically the fully unedited photo, including the crop that I applied. You can see here how I clearly cropped in. So when I click on original, I can go over here and I can start editing however I want. Like I can really quickly just get a custom white balance. Let's try one of the newer tools. And that's also another important thing about re-editing your photos. When I initially took this photo and edited it, there were a ton of tools in Lightroom that were not available. And you know, it's just one of those things where as new tools come out, I'm always thinking about, can I take this image and can I make it even better by using these new tools? For example, here, the adaptive color profile, which was just introduced into Lightroom not too long ago. You can see how it does a really great job of just, basically, I could be done with this with the exception of doing some spot healing or some cropping. So like here, I'll just crop in just like before, maybe something like that. And then I can go to the healing tool here and just get rid of a few things like this. And of course, if I needed to use generative AI, I could by enabling this checkbox, which will give me the generative remove brush. Again, a tool that was not available when I first edited this photo. All right, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time editing this. I just want to kind of show you like really quickly, you know, if you apply a treatment to the photo that is different than before. So again, something like this, maybe add a sky mask and let's add a little bit of dehaze to it. And cool, we're good. Like if you hit the backslash key, this is what we started with. This is what we edited. And now what I can do is I can save this as a version. So I'll go to versions over here. I'm going to create another version and I'll call this 2025 edit and click create. And so the cool part is now I can hover between my new edit and my original one to kind of see how things have changed. Like here, yeah, this is just not something I would want to do these days, but this is definitely more in line with kind of my aesthetic. So I love that I have these here. And of course I can always go back to the original. So that first use case for versions is preserving your original edits so that you can try something else. The second use case is similar, except it doesn't really have anything to do with your original edit. It has to do with your ability to quickly compare different presets or styles or treatments to see if one kind of stands out over another, or if you want to just have different versions like a color edit and a black and white edit. So let me show you that right now. All right, so here, this is a photo taken at Arches National Park. This is totally unedited. If I press the backslash key, you can see it's unedited. Now, I'm not going to make any edits. What I'm going to do is I'm going to click on the presets browser from the toolbar over here, and I'm in the recommended section. Now, I've got a video that I'm going to link right above here to why the recommended presets section is so awesome, especially because it's a great way to kind of go down different roads that you might not expect. So here, like if I hover over, like this is actually pretty cool. Like I like this preset. And so if I click on it, I'll apply it. And of course I've got my amount slider here so I can control the strength of that preset. Now let's say that I like this preset and I wanna preserve it, but I still wanna try other presets that I have here. What I can do is I can click on this ellipsis over here on the top right of the preset thumbnail. And right here, there is save as version. And I can call this whatever I want. Like I can call this kind of like warm preset. I don't know. As you've watched my videos, anytime I have to name something, I just go super basic, but call it whatever you want. I'm going to go ahead and click on create, and then I'm going to go and reset that. So we're back to our original. Then I'll start hovering over, like maybe I want a black and white treatment. This might work, or I can go to the black and white category over here, and I can start kind of hovering over some of these presets like this one's kind of cool. And what I like about it is that I can click on this more like this button, which will give me similar presets to the one that I selected. So you can kind of see here, like this one I like. So I'm going to go ahead and click on the ellipsis. And just like before, I'm going to select save as version and I'll call this black and white preset. And now if I go to my versions over here, you can see there are the two presets. And again, these will sync to all other Lightroom surfaces. And so then I can click over here and enable these settings. I can go to the edit tools here and refine them however I want on Lightroom desktop, Lightroom mobile, or Lightroom web. So for the third use case of versions, I've been using this all the time, especially lately, because I've become kind of obsessed with editing in 32-bit HDR. Now, unfortunately, this screen recording software that I have can't capture HDR video, which is very frustrating because I absolutely love it. I think it's still, we're still kind of in early days with this kind of HDR. I'm not talking about, you know, going to photo merge and then HDR. This is editing in true 32-bit HDR. When you see it, it looks amazing. But here's my point. What I can do here is, this is an unedited photo. So let's just say, you know, I really quickly just go ahead and I select adaptive color. Let's just say this is the edit. Like maybe I'll make it a little bit brighter. So this image is currently in SDR. And if I export it, you will see it pretty much as is. Like there are no concerns there. If I share it to you over a text message or if I share it on Instagram or any other platform, this is pretty much what you'll see. And because I want to have quick access to both an SDR and HDR version, this is where versions comes in perfectly. So I'm going to go to versions over here. I'm going to select create version, and I'm going to just call this SDR edit. In fact, I might just call this 2025 SDR edit because I might go back in a few years and re-edit this. And then I can go back to the editing tools, and now I can enable HDR. Now, this probably will look terrible in the video, like it's going to probably be totally blown out. And that's the frustrating part about this. On my screen, though, this looks amazing. Like all of the details and the highlights in the sky look awesome. In fact, the top of the snow looks great. It requires a little bit of editing that I can do. But the point is that what I would do now is I would go to versions here and I would create another version. And I'd call this 2025 HDR edit. So now I have both edits ready to go. You can see here if I go between them, I have access to them on all of my Lightroom surfaces. Now, again, if you're kind of unfamiliar with HDR, definitely check out my friend Greg Benz. I'm going to leave a link to his website in the description below. He's like the HDR whisperer. He is pushing HDR forward for all of us in the best ways, and I really appreciate his efforts. So if you kind of want to learn more, he does an amazing job of showcasing actual HDR edits and video, so check him out. Now, for the fourth and final use case for versions, this is actually practical for most people, especially if you like to share your photos on social media, especially Instagram. So here you can see this is already an edited photo that I took. If I hit the backslash key, this is the unedited version, and this is my edit. Now, let's say I want to share this on Instagram, but I really can't determine if I want this to be a square crop, which is the kind of default aspect ratio for Instagram, or a vertical crop. Well, now I don't need to really guess, because what I can do here is I can go to cropping. So I'll just go here. I'm going to select my aspect dropdown, and I'm going to select 1:1, which is a square. And now what I can do is I can just, you know, crop this however I want. So let's say that is my square crop. What I can do is I can go to versions here, create a version, and I'm just going to call this square crop. And then I'm going to click on create. But then, like I said, maybe I want a vertical crop. And in Instagram, they use a 4:5 aspect ratio. So what I would do is I would go back to crop over here and I would reset it so that I'm back to my original crop. I'd start cropping in a bit here. And then I'm going to change my aspect ratio to 5:4, which is still in a horizontal configuration. But all I need to do is press on the X key to turn it vertical. So now we went from 5:4 to 4:5. And I can position this kind of like this. Cool. So now what I'll do is I'll go back to versions and I'm going to create another version and I'm going to call this 4:5 crop. Now here's the cool thing. Let's say I need to export both of these crops that I just saved versions of. I can do that very easily by clicking on this ellipse on the top right here. And you can see export all named versions as a small JPEG or a large JPEG. So I'm going to go with large. I'll save it to my desktop. And now when I go to my desktop, you'll see there is my 4:5 crop, my square crop, and the original. You can just see them right here, exactly how I save them, and the original, which again, because the original technically is always a default named version, you'll get that as part of exporting all named versions, which is fine because you can just delete it. All right, so The thing I love about Versions is just how versatile it is, especially because you can get really creative with how you use it. And so I hope that you seeing the ways that I use it, because I use the four examples I gave you, I use those all the time. So I hope that you kind of incorporate it into your workflow, especially if you use Lightroom Desktop, Lightroom Mobile, or Lightroom Web. Remember, you don't have to use all three of these surfaces. If you're primarily a Lightroom Mobile user, you can still use Versions. And if you are a Lightroom Mobile subscriber, you get access to Lightroom Web, so those versions will be waiting for you as well. Now, if you want to learn everything there is to know about Lightroom, then check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. I'll leave a link to it in the description below. And I mentioned that I have this video that will dive deeper into how Versions work, so check that out. If you found this video helpful, please do click on the thumbs up. It really does help the channel. And be sure to click on subscribe and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.